So my name is Danielle Spiegelfeld. I'm the Executive Director of the Guarini Center here at NYU Law. And on behalf of all of our staff, Foley, the faculty, Professor Stewart, and Katrina Wyman, I want to welcome you to this discussion on energy policy in the Trump administration. I think that it's clear that the topic is quite timely, especially just today with the President issuing, President Trump issuing an executive order to basically resurrect the Keystone pipeline, which was more or less dead under the Obama administration. There's a lot to discuss. The question is how much is changing and how fast, not whether it's changing. And thankfully, we have a great panel of experts here to help us to sort through all the issues at hand. I won't provide extensive bios because they've all been provided at the entrance, so we want to make the best use of the time we have. But I will just run through and identify all of the panelists. So first, we have Robert Seber, who's a partner at Vinson and Elkins, and also an adjunct professor of law here at the law school. At the end, we have Thomas Tate, head of energy policy research for Evercore, ISI. Next to him, we have John Elwood, partner at Vinson and Elkins. And we have Jayni Foley Hein, policy director at the Institute for Policy Integrity. And finally, Alexandra Teitz, who is fresh from government office, where she was counselor to the director of the Department of Interior, among many other positions. So just before handing it over to Robert, I just wanted to extend my gratitude to him and the firm for their support in putting this together. Robert is, as I mentioned, an adjunct professor and teaches a very popular course in oil and gas law. He's also one of the leading experts in the country, really, not in the field, and we're delighted to have his support and collaboration.
Well, thank you very much, Danielle. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for joining us here tonight. So last fall, I guess we all got two pieces of news that many of us probably didn't expect. One was for Bob Dylan to win the Nobel Prize in Literature, and the other one was for Donald Trump to become the president. So tonight is an opportunity to bring it all together in the context of energy policy. And we have an amazing panel here. Here's what how we want to do it. We will, as Danielle mentioned, there has been very relevant news today regarding the executive orders of the pipelines. We will talk about it, we will get to it, but honestly, we also don't want to be drowned out by the news of the day and maintain a broader perspective here and talk about more broadly what we can expect in terms of energy policy from this administration and also what may not happen. We are not going to do, as Aaron mentioned, a long introduction on bios and everybody's accomplishments, but I would like to just briefly describe what perspective everybody plays here. And so starting on my side, next to me is Alexandra, who left the government last week. I guess officially unemployed, but that's not the perspective we are asking for today here. Alexander was the counselor to the director of the Bureau of Land Management within the Department of Interior. And it is not a well-known, publicly well-known fact that the federal government actually owns 28% of all the land in the United States, and it is the BLM that manages it, including the natural resources on that land. And so the BLM policies with regard to natural resources and oil and gas is very much a microcosm of energy policy in the administration overall. And that's particularly that perspective that we appreciate from her. Jayni is the policy director of the Institute for Policy Integrity here at NYU, and she's a think tank. She also teaches this term a class on natural resources. resources and policy. So think tank policy. She has been the co-author of several reports on energy matters, including on the federal coal reform and on modernizing the federal oil and gas leasing program. So it's we will turn to her for policy perspectives on elements of the anticipated energy policy of the new administration. My partner in my law firm, John Elwood, is a Washington litigator. He is, as far as I know, not holding himself out as an energy lawyer or energy regulatory lawyer per se, but what John knows very well about are the intricacies of Washington and what particular legislative and administrative steps are actually required when it comes to implementing policies, and we will appreciate, you know, his insights in that regard. And then finally, Tom, who also happens to be a lawyer, we all lawyers who are law school graduates on this panel, he made the decision shortly after law school to go in a different direction, and he's the head of energy policy research at Evercore, and so he's very much brings a business and investor perspective to energy policy matters, unlike, for example, Jayni, who is involved in formulating policy proposals. Tom looks at given policies or policy proposals from the perspective of what does it mean for the market, what does it mean for investors. And so we hope that the different perspectives here will make for an interesting conversation. Let me start with a presidential quote. I will go before Congress with a comprehensive plan to make our country independent of foreign sources of energy. Our energy plan will include a number of specific goals to measure our progress toward a stable energy system. They include cutting half the portion of United States oil which is imported, increase our coal production by about two-thirds. Under my presidency, we will accomplish complete American energy independence. We will get the bureaucracy out of the way of innovation so we can pursue all forms of energy. Reforms in leasing policies and the removal of unnecessary environmental restrictions upon the production, delivery, and use of energy are part of the same effort to reduce bureaucratic burdens on all Americans. Now, maybe you realize the trick here. So these are all quotes, presidential quotes, but they are actually quotes from four different presidents. Ford, Carter, Reagan, and Trump. And so it's not new that presidents and administrations come into office with ambitious goals on energy and with ambitious energy plans. So my initial question, and first addressed to Alexandra, will it be different this time? How do the declared energy policy goals of Trump and this administration differ from predecessors? And what do you think we should expect over the next few years, both short term and more long term?
Well, it's interesting you did four quotes from presidents further back, but certainly the George W. Bush administration also came in with very much that similar sort of perspective, and we saw the Cheney Energy Task Force, for example, pursuing many of the I think very similar policies that we will see under President Trump as well. I think that obviously, administrations do make a difference in energy policy and in terms of what happens in terms of energy production and use in our country, particularly in situations as here where we have a
full Republican control of the Congress as well, they have an opportunity to make some more substantial changes in energy direction than has previously been the case. But as some of the quotes indicate, I think that they never quite reach the goals set out in terms of the full extent. So it'll be interesting to see how far they want to go and where we land.
But where would you expect changes to occur?
Certainly, I think policies will be very positive towards oil and gas. In particular, I think we're going to see a lot of overall, obviously, attacks, pushback on regulation, and then very specific ones to be rolled back, as well as perpetual targets of Republican right reform efforts, such as the National Environmental Policy Act, environmental analysis process, the requirement for that for projects, and also the Endangered Species Act. Those are pieces of the permitting process that tend to be viewed as burdensome by the energy production industries, and so there will be a big push for that. Those are pieces that have to be dealt with, for the most part, legislatively. But I think that with the majority in Congress, they will see a push for that. The other area I think that we'll see as well is tax policy. When George W. Bush came in, we saw there was a big surplus. So there was a very large push for tax reforms that would have allowed substantial, by one reckoning, we came up with the 2001 energy bill in Congress at that time, which was sort of following on policies of Cheney Energy Task Force, $19 billion in tax relief for energy industries. So there's certainly, I think it's going to be harder to do now with deficit concerns, but there will be a push on tax policy as well.
What's your perspective?
Yeah, I would agree with a lot of what Alexandra mentioned. From my perspective, I think what we've seen early on, thus far, in terms of public statements by the Trump administration, is a more friendly administration towards fossil fuel interests, and sort of a stepping away from any emphasis on renewable energy production, especially on federal lands, certainly markedly less attention and public pronouncements around climate change and the need to act in order to reduce the threat of climate change. So the Trump administration recently released its America First Energy Plan. And in just reviewing that, it struck me two omissions. One, that there was no mention of renewable energy anywhere in that America First Energy Plan. Even though it talks about the need to reduce dependence on foreign sources of oil and energy. And then two, there was no mention of climate change other than the desire to get rid of the climate action plan that was passed under the Obama administration. And that was very striking because, we'll talk about public lands, and Robert introduced, how much authority Interior has over public lands, and they also have a lot of authority over leasing renewable energy on those lands. And so that struck me. Another thing that is more of something I'm wondering and will keep my eyes on as the administration gets underway, but how will the new administration be receptive to, or potentially not receptive to, win-win solutions that the Obama administration was in the process of contemplating? And specifically, I'm talking about coal reform and federal coal reform. There was a programmatic environmental review process that was launched about a year ago by the Department of the Interior, and most recently culminated in a scoping report just about a week ago that makes very clear that there are some reforms that could be made to the federal coal program, to its fiscal terms, to the way that leases are planned, to increase competition, that really seem like win-win solutions for taxpayers and the environment. And so it remains to be seen whether the new administration will be open to those and receptive to those, or whether they will try to back away from them and fall back on the more traditional party lines that, may want to keep the coal program as a status quo.
We'll get back to coal specifically in a moment, but to continue the opening out here, John, in terms of a general perspective,
so
what do you expect?
So I'm not an energy lawyer, but I'm at an energy firm. And so I have perhaps the knowledge of medicine that a child of doctors has, but I have absorbed an awful lot. And to begin with the answer, I think that this administration has a much better chance of achieving energy independence because of fracking, which has really turned the world upside down in some ways and turned the United States from a net importer to a net exporter, at least there's a prospect of that. And then another thing is that, one of the calling cards of the incoming Trump administration was that they weren't tainted by Washington. But one thing that they haven't really figured out is that, Congress is a place of its own with, 535 people who have very big egos, and they're going to do what is in their own best interest. And so even though the Trump administration may not have a place for renewables, there are people from farm states that are big and empty and have lots of wind who want those credits. There are the people who make the blades for the turbines. There are people who build the turbines. And all of them have an incentive for keeping these tax breaks going along. And unless a tax break is explicitly sunsetted, and I don't know whether these are or not, things live in the tax code forever. And so I wouldn't be at all surprised if, the tax breaks keep going, or if they are renewed, if there are sunsetted provision, if they are renewed, just because of the demands within Congress and, how one hand washes the other that it manages to get done, even if it's not a priority of the Trump administration.
Well, Tom, what do you tell you and the rest of the audience?
Sure. Well, first, thanks, Robert, for hosting the event. Thanks, everyone, for joining us this evening. So I'm going to turn the question on its head a little bit, and I've been on the phone with investors all day today on the back of this Keystone and Decoder Access news that we heard. So the investors I speak to, they generally have a much shorter time frame when they want to hear about energy policy. So they don't want to hear what might happen in a year or what might happen in 4 years. They want to hear what will happen in the first 100 days or what will happen next week, which makes my job obviously very very interesting. So I think the way that we focus on this is what is actionable in the first 100 days within the Trump administration on energy policy. And probably there's four kind of key takeaways or key areas that we have focused on in the last few weeks since Trump won the election in terms of energy. So number one, I think just going international, so going outside of the US, this is more of a geopolitical observation, and that's thinking about Iran and sanctions and the potential for the new Secretary of State, likely Rex Tillerson, or now Rex Tillerson, to snap back sanctions on Iran and what the implications might be for the crude markets. Now, that's potentially a million barrels a day of supply side tightening in the crude markets, clearly very, very consequential and impactful for the crude market. So I think that's one area where we would focus on, and I'm happy to continue that discussion. Number two is in the midstream and the pipe space, and as Robert has alluded to, we've already heard some interesting news vis-a-vis executive orders on Keystone and DAPL, the Decoder Access project, today. I think from the investors I spoke to, not really a surprise. This was something that Trump discussed doing. This was campaign rhetoric. And actually, again, I'm an investment guy. The stocks really didn't respond in an overly, let's say, excited manner today. We saw about a 3% increase in energy transfer partners, which is the Foley, owner of the Decoder Access project. So I do think there's a lot of work and a lot of advancement in the midstream space. I think we'll continue to see that. I think the last one is tax reform, as Alex alluded to. We're getting a lot of questions on the border-adjusted tax issue, and particularly on energy, that's the potential to actually tax imports on crude oil. Now, clearly for the refiners, this is an absolute nightmare. Arguably a positive for the E&Ps, that's the exploration and production companies. I think far too early in the tax reform discussion and debate to really have a true sense of where this is going, but I will tell you, certainly from a markets and from an investor perspective, that is by far and large the number one issue that we're addressing right now. So I'll pause there, but just in terms of actionable items, I think those three are all we're focused on as of now.
Okay, well, thank you. So that we do get the news of the day out of the way, let's clarify. If you you're attending this event, you're interested in energy, so you've probably heard today about those executive orders. But let's clarify what they actually mean or don't mean. John, can we ask you to help with that?
Sure. So he issued two, they're captured memorandums, they're basically directives to the relevant people at the agencies to hurry it up. They say expedite it. But one thing that is very telling is that right in there, bacon with all of it, is language about, you know, to the extent appropriate. And I mean, there's so many weasel words in there that this, candidly, I don't think the news really do any more than picking up the phone and saying, hurry it up, except that there's something you can point to say, obviously I think this is very important. So, there's really, in a way, it's very measured because it says you're supposed to consider all the sort of relevant legal requirements. And the main thing is to proceed quickly with them and to expedite review. I think that is the most important thing about both of these things. The one thing that I think is especially interesting about Keystone Access Pipeline is that the president has the power traditionally to handle, things crossing the border. So I think the last president who did that himself was Kennedy. But, even though he has delegated this power to the Secretary of State, and Kerry is the guy who for the Obama administration said it's not in the U.S. interest to have Keystone cross the border. It's a bedrock principle of administrative law that a delegated power can be exercised by the person who did the delegating. And if Trump really wanted to be forward-leaning, he could have just done it himself. And it would have the additional benefit from his perspective of he is not subject to Administrative Procedure Act review. And that's one thing that's interesting. Admittedly, there's not an application pending for Keystone. And one of the things that I think is most interesting, and perhaps unprecedented in executive memoranda, is that the first line of it is essentially to encourage Keystone to submit an application.
Well, of course, John is yet to be precise, but there's also then public perception. And so I was just checking this afternoon some of the headlines, and they read like Trump moonlights Keystone XL and Dakota Access Pipeline, or Trump orders revival of pipelines. And then about half an hour before I went down here from my office, a client asked me on the phone what the pipeline bill is about that Trump signed today. Of course, there was no bill in the signing. But so, perception and the symbolic effect of actions of this kind are not to be, underestimated. And Alexander, what do you think? How do you view the symbolism in this?
Oh, I think the symbolism is very clear, and it's in line with taking down the climate website and the White House climate website and putting in place discussion of the energy plan without any positive mention of addressing climate change. I think that a very big piece of what we will see, what we have seen from Trump, is the public communication and the brand, the image, the I am doing something, I'm keeping jobs here, I'm creating jobs, and it is interesting as John points out that there may be a lot less to some of the actions, especially the initial ones, than meets the eye, because it does take time to do things in Washington. We did have a Keystone XL pipeline bill that directed the president to go ahead and approve it or allowed it to go forward in the House of Representatives, and of course that didn't make it through the Senate. But back during the Obama administration, this is simply saying if and when we get another application back, then I want you to go ahead and do it. I think where some of the interesting things to keep an eye on with both of these is what happens with the NEPA review, the environmental review of these pipelines, because in terms of whether or not they're adequate to withstand litigation, at think it would be very hard for someone to challenge, or harder at least, to challenge the Keystone XL process, where you have a very, very detailed environmental impact statement and process. In the Dakota Access setting, a lot less has been done, and I think that challenges may be easier to bring in that case. And so if they want to protect themselves against challenge, they're going to need to think about what is the, you know, the proper process and how much they really can hurry up.
Any additional views on and responses to Alexandra?
I mean, I can weigh in, I guess, just again from an investor perspective. I suppose that the optics, particularly around, so actually on Keystone and on DAPL, but I think from an investor perspective, not many investors actually care about Keystone anymore. And I don't mean to sound that in a pejorative fashion, but I mean, even TransCanada kind of walked away from the project, although today the CEO actually released a press release saying that they would be filing their reapplication, surprise, surprise, in an expedient fashion per the press release today. But I think optically from an investor perspective, there's far less of a, I don't want to say a lack of care, but they don't really actually focus or care on, I think, one of the most important pieces of the paradigm here, and it's actually how Trump deals with the response of the tribe and some of the protesters right on the ground. And I was actually quite shocked at the fact that he actually just decided to issue this executive order or memorandum today, with really just paying no heed or coming up with some way of dealing what I think will be a very, very aggressive, negative response from the tribe in sort of day three of his office. Now, again, investors in energy transfer don't really care about that. They just want to see the project get done and get approved as quickly as possible. And I think no doubt in our minds that this executive order slash memoranda lays the pathway to an expedited approval likely within the first 100 days. And actually, since the DAPL rejection that we saw, I guess, in September of 2016, we've always maintained a kind of Q1 2017 time frame for this, notwithstanding all the noise that we've seen in the media, predominantly really through the lens that President Trump would do exactly what he did today. So that would just be my two cents.
I'll be interested to see if they can get it done that quickly, just because I thought there was a big
block on
Dakota Access Pipeline done that quickly, because they've announced this intention to do an environmental impact statement, and I don't know how quickly you can walk that back. You know, that you might have to have, like, I don't know the intricacies, but I think you might need a finding of no significant impact or something in order to walk back from the EIS, and I just don't know how quickly any of that can be done.
John, does that executive order issued today give him the ability to walk back from that quickly, though, or no?
No, I think because it basically just says do what you can as quickly as you can. That's the way I essentially read it. So I think it's like do everything you can with all deliberate speed, but they still have to go through the process.
And that's what I was referring to in terms of the vulnerability there, is that I believe they only have an environmental assessment, which is sort of a mini environmental impact statement. It's what you do if you think the project is less significant. And that review had received a lot of criticism, including from EPA. It was beyond the core of engineers' review. So it is not entirely clear whether they can immediately move forward without doing an EIS, or they certainly could do that, but what their legal vulnerability would be if they do that.
I guess just one additional point on Keystone as well, which I was talking about with an investor today. If we assume in a perfect world that TransCanada issue their application, and the State Department, as directed by Mr. Trump and Secretary Tillerson, decide to approve the cross-border permitting piece, there's still a lot of problems in the U.S. with Keystone. Nebraska, the state of Nebraska, never actually finally issued the permit for construction on KXL through the proposed reroute of Nebraska. Now, there's a lot of Republicans in Nebraska that voted for Donald Trump. He's going to have to go out and declare eminent domain in Nebraska and take a lot of land away from a lot of voters in Nebraska that voted for him and put him into the White House. So I think there's a lot of unintended consequences here as well that maybe unsurprisingly the Trump administration have not necessarily got a grasp around as yet on this one.
Yeah, I would just add one thing that's interesting, I think, about Keystone XL is that, so the EIS was finalized at some point in 2014, and...
Okay, we had a deal before the panel, no acronyms, 2016.
The environmental impact statement was finalized in 2014, and some of that analysis is dependent upon oil prices, and is transparent about that fact. And so, you know, it may be necessary to update it, at least with the new oil price projections. And certainly it was relevant to, you know, whether there would be a net increase in greenhouse gas emissions from building the pipeline or not, because in a not building it scenario, the alternative for the oil to move around the country is via rail, and when oil prices fall too much, rail becomes, in some cases, prohibitively expensive. So that's why these prices matter, and there may be, you know, some additional analysis that needs to be done.
Let's pick up on coal, which Jayni mentioned in her opening statement. So if you, you know, if this is about additional energy sources for us, renewable energy in the context of climate change concerns, well, we actually, as a country, we peaked on oil and gas production in the last few years. So it was the Obama administration that set on, it was in power in the year in which the United States had the highest oil and gas production ever. The same is not true for coal. Coal has been declining consistently for 10 years now. And just for background, 42% of all coal in the United States, produced in the United States, is produced on federal land. So the attitude of BLM towards coal leasing very much determines the policy, but if you look at the longer trend here, so if there is a war on coal, as is sometimes claimed, well, the real enemy or the real army that's fighting the coal is natural gas prices and not any policy. So would you, Jayni, expect that the underlying economic forces at work here can actually be influenced by the administration one way or the other?
You know, I think the clear trend is actually a continuing move away from coal as a primary energy sector power source, and with natural gas continuing to make up a larger share of that, and renewable energy as well. And so I don't think that's likely to change. And the Trump administration, when it has made the few public statements it's made about its energy policy, indicates that it would like to accelerate leasing of oil, gas, and coal, even though oil and gas, specifically gas, oftentimes is in direct competition with coal. So those are a bit contradictory. And I don't actually think that you know, any potential Trump administration policies will do much to slow those market trends. That seems driven more by, again, natural gas prices and shifts in, you know, how power plants operate. And as more coal-fired power plants retire and it becomes more cost-effective to just bring more natural gas and energy efficiency and renewables online, I think the trend away from coal is bound to continue. So I don't think there's going to be a big change. Where I see the potential biggest contrast between the Obama administration and the Trump administration on coal is, again, around this ongoing reform process that Interior launched. And it seems that there may be an attempt to kind of move away from that rather than take up some of these reforms that have been considered and supported by a wide variety of stakeholders.
I agree very much with what Jayni just said. A couple of other things. I mean, one interesting thing that's been happening is, along with natural gas prices being a primary driver of our move away from coal, we've also had stabilizing energy use, or no longer rapidly increasing. I think it maybe even falling recently. So in terms of electricity production and demand, to the extent, and some of that has been driven by the efficiency policies. The Department of Energy has been putting out efficiency standards throughout the Obama administration that have really taken a big bite out of the sort of up to this point increasing electricity demand over times. And I think one thing we will see is that the enthusiasm for those types of continuous improvements in terms of demand side management of energy and increased efficiency, at least in terms of federal mandates for that, we may well see less of that. I don't think anyone's building any new coal plants anytime soon in the U.S. So in terms of that aspect of coal demand, it's really more, do we stabilize where we are now, or do we continue to decline as rapidly as we would have under the Clean Power Plan? And that's the other big piece that we haven't talked about, but certainly the Clean Power Plan, which was EPA's directive to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from the power sector coal plants. The Trump administration has made clear that they want to get rid of that. Congress will certainly help them do that. And the question is, without that, it appears likely that we would not make the same progress in terms of reducing coal and greenhouse gases as we would otherwise, assuming that they're successful in rolling that back.
Well, this is by necessity a very technical conversation. There are many elements administrative, legislative elements that play into this. You mentioned the Clean Power Plan. John, can you help us again? Like, what is it and what is its current status and what is likely to happen to it?
Sure. Clean Power Plan is an effort by EPA to reduce greenhouse gases. I think there's currently a challenge pending in front of the D.C. Circuit, which is a rare case that courts heard on bank, and which was argued, and it's still pending. I was kind of surprised that they didn't get a decision out before January 20th, but I think maybe there's a lot there, and there are a lot of opinions. I think the most controversial part of it, and I think that the part that is the most likely to be sort of rejected is, or that the Trump administration is most likely to get rid of, is basically something more or less, requiring, and this is a very bad paraphrase, requiring basically the operators of power plants that if they have too much basically carbon-based stuff, that they got to start folding in renewables, which is, I think, an aggressive reading of the Clean Air Act. And that is, I think, one of the things that is most likely to be taken out quickly by the Trump administration. We should have a ruling fairly soon by the D.C. Circuit. When Justice Scalia died and it looked like he was going to be replaced by a Democratic president, it looked like the writing was on the wall that it was probably likely to be upheld by the Supreme Court. But if the replacement is seated by Trump, I think that it's a much different role. Because remember, the Clean Power Plan, after they didn't get an injunction, after the challengers, the state of West Virginia and Texas, challenged it in the D.C. Circuit, got nowhere on the preliminary injunction stage, the Supreme Court issued a stay. And it is very rare for the Supreme Court to issue a stay. And admittedly, in the small number of cases that I've heard of, where the Supreme Court issued a stay, the side that got the stay has won in 100% of the cases. In that case, N equals like 4. But it's still it's a very good sign when the Supreme Court will give you a stay, which is a long way of saying that it's probably doomed if a Trump justice is seated.
Tom, your perspective on coal and
Sure. So, I mean, I pretty much agree with, I guess that's good, we have a universal agreement on the state of coal in the U.S. From an investor perspective, this is on or off the record, I guess, so I won't say the firm, but I collectively am short the coal market in the U.S. I don't think we see really any investable opportunities or indeed any policy intervention that can help foster investable opportunities in coal. My only, I guess, comment or caveat that I would add to the rest of the panel's remarks is one of the, I guess one of the lenses that we haven't talked about on the panel yet that I think we believe will help or guide Trump in some of his policies, particularly in energy, is this need or this desire to give back to certain states that helped him win the election. Now, when I talk about that, if we think about it through the lens of coal, Senator Mitch McConnell has made it very clear to President Trump that he expects him to do something about the coal industry. The question, I think, for everybody in the room and for everybody in the panel is, what exactly is he supposed to do? You can't throw a tax credit at the problem. We talked about gas prices. We do not see a competitive spread, I think, developing whereby coal becomes the choice vis-a-vis LNG, at least probably for the next 5 to 7 years, most likely much longer. So, as I said, I think for us, we think the proverbial nail is most definitely in the coffin for coal going forward.
I don't want to give up on passing you on that for a moment, despite unanimous perspective. So on Friday, it took an hour for the energy, America First Energy Plan to go up on the White House website 1 hour after the inauguration. And one of its first few paragraphs is, the Trump administration is committed to clean coal technology and to reviving America's coal industry, which has been burning for too long. If the underlying economics and trends are so clear, what do we know that the White House doesn't know, or what else is at work here? And one possibility, if almost half of coal is produced on federal land, would be to make it available at lower royalty rates. Is that in the cards?
I have a point on that one. When the Bureau of Land Management, basically Secretary Jewell said about a year ago at the Department of Interior, she said that she wanted to have an open and honest conversation about the federal coal program. 42% of U.S. coal is produced on federal lands, so huge input to total U.S. greenhouse gas emissions. About 10 or 11% total U.S. greenhouse gas emissions come from coal owned by the American public, and so that has raised some questions about whether that's really a good idea and whether we should be producing all that coal. Also questions about if you didn't produce it from federal lands, federal minerals, then would we just get a sort of increase in coal production elsewhere or some partial increase in coal production elsewhere. One of the, anyway, in the course of doing this review that culminated in the scoping report that Jayni mentioned, which was the first step of an programmatic environmental impact process, which is basically just a review of the federal coal program. One of the interesting things that came out is that, jobs in coal country have been declining for a very long time. And one of the primary drivers of that has been mechanization in the industry and a shift to Western low sulfur coal that happened to a significant degree in the Clean Air Act Amendments of 1990, where cleaner burning Western coal, not cleaner from a climate perspective, but cleaner from an SO2 perspective, helped boost that market. And it has been continuing because in the West we have coal seams that are 6, 7, 8 feet thick, and in Appalachia they're down here. So it's a lot more expensive to mine it there, and the industry is simply moving away. But even if you push more production of federal coal, which I think would be hard to do to any substantial extent, I think in terms of the job impacts, it's going to be very, very minimal, because really the more federal coal you throw onto the market, the more Western coal, Powder River Basin coal specifically, the less Appalachian coal you get, and then fewer jobs actually overall, under some analyses.
Any additions to the coal discussion?
Well, one thing is, it is true. I mean, Powder River Basin is going to be where the coal will be produced. And you talk about jobs, there are bigger and bigger machines that are doing that, fewer and fewer people employed. And I think that within a few years, they're going to have, autonomous dump trucks carrying the stuff. So, I mean, it's really the case where the jobs aren't going to be coming back.
Yeah, you know, so 2 points. So one on the jobs front, I would agree with all that's been said. Second thing is, most of Powder River Basin coal comes from Wyoming. And Wyoming also has incredible wind energy potential. Mm-hmm. And so when we're talking about job creation, I mean, such a natural place to look would be, how do you funnel people into those wind energy jobs? And how do you help with, moving that energy to load centers through streamlining or helping with transmission? The second point I would make in response to Robert's question about royalty rates. So a lot of work was done through this scoping process that looked at adjustments to royalty rates. There were three studies that actually looked at raising royalty rates and what the effects of doing that would be on coal production, emissions, and overall revenue from the coal program that goes half to the federal treasury and half to the state where the federal land lies and where the coal is produced. And all three of those studies, one of which we did here at Policy Integrity, found that raising the royalty rate by a different amount would actually increase overall federal revenue to taxpayers. And one of the studies was actually done by the White House Council of Economic Advisors, and it looked at a royalty rate that would actually attempt to maximize social welfare, and it found that it would be significantly higher than the current 12.5% statutory minimum rate. It would be over 300%, just using a percentage basis, or in other words, translating it from about $1 per ton of coal right now to about $30 per ton of coal. And that study also looked at how coal production would shift a bit from different basins. But again, this analysis just doesn't support reducing the royalty rate.
Well, we have 45 minutes in, and so far we have managed with how we talk about oil and gas, so let's run to that now. Jayni, if you don't mind, we'll stay with you because you have spent much time on the federal oil and gas lease program, on particularly onshore. Can you tell us what's going on and what's if anything will change about it? And if it does it make a difference?
Yeah, so there's been sort of a little bit less action in terms from a policy standpoint than for onshore oil and gas than there has been for coal. But many of the same mechanisms and suggestions for reform were at play. One of the biggest ones being the onshore oil and gas royalty rate for federal oil and gas is, again, 12.5%. That's lower than a lot of states, which use rates more like 16.75 and 18. Sometimes up to 25% in Texas. And so there has been a movement to try to raise those rates. Now, we're probably not going to see that in the next administration. So that is something that is likely to be stalled. What we're probably likely to see is more lease sales. So one thing that happened under the Obama administration is they actually canceled some lease sales of oil and gas that were scheduled. And they just kind of took them off the schedule and said, we don't need to do this. We have more than enough active leases for supply. And so we'll probably see an acceleration of those sales. Another thing to watch out for is, when Interior and BLM does these lease sales, it often prepares or needs to prepare environmental impact statements. And so we'll be looking at, what goes into those. Under the Obama administration, the Council for Environmental Quality, or CEQ, said that those need to contain an analysis of greenhouse gas emissions, both upstream and downstream. And they issued some final guidance, clarifying that. And we certainly hope that will continue to be the practice. But people will be watching that as well.
Well, so your focus, has been mostly on royalty rates as such, but are there, that's a question to all of you, is it possible possible that there are broader changes, structural changes in the works? For example, selling federal land. You know, why is the federal government still the owner of 28% of all the land in the country, or transferring ownership to the states? Does any of you expect more fundamental changes in that regard?
I don't necessarily think that is likely. So Ryan Zinke, who's been proposed as the next Secretary of Interior, has publicly said he's sort of against these land transfers. It's unclear that the federal government would have a strong incentive to do that, in fact. So that's not something that I'm necessarily expecting to see, and I'm curious what other people think.
Alexandra?
I think it's less likely that they would do a lot of or do a substantial policy shift in terms of outright sales of public lands, but there have been some noises about increasing state role in managing public lands, and I think Seber says something about that in his confirmation hearings. And as a practical matter, BLM is a very, Bureau of Land Management is a very decentralized agency, right? They have these field offices and state directors out in the West, and their relationships with local government, with the governors of the states and the congressional delegations are very important. And even under the Obama administration, I think that the Bureau was very interested in sort of local and state views on where and what they should be leasing. And they tried to do a balancing act, right, in terms of saying, no, in these areas there's too much opposition in terms of it's wilder land or land with wilderness characteristics, or there's other sort of impact concerns in terms of species, et cetera. But over here, you know, we're going to go ahead and lease. I think that balance will shift quite dramatically under the Trump administration and go back to much more what we saw under the Bush administration, where oil companies that are able to propose parcels basically for leasing that they're interested in. And I think that there will be a lot less pushback on their favorite parcels, and if they happen to be rather close to a national park or some other area of concern, that may be not a problem under this administration as it would have been in the past. On the other hand, the one other point I would make is that U.S. domestic oil production increased 88% between 2008 and 2015. So even under the supposedly restrictive, difficult, hard to get your permits, hard to lease Obama administration, actually there was the shale oil revolution occurred and it went forward, and there have been a tremendous number of wells newly permitted, areas leased and wells permitted and drilled and produced. So they're going to have to it's unclear to me exactly how much further there is to go. Certainly they will do a lot more of it, and certainly there'll be less attention to sensitive areas, but I'll be interested to see, and I'd be interested to hear maybe Tom's view or others in terms of how much more growth there is, or how much taking the reins off, the supposed reins off, will actually increase production.
Sure. We've done quite a bit of work in this space, actually. I think for us, the big takeaway on permitting is, to your point, Alex, streamlining to the extent that we can the current permitting problem. And we actually looked, and I think for us, there are certain E&Ps, exploration and production companies. New Mexico is a great example where there's a lot of oil there that these guys are looking to get access to. A lot of these E&P companies have historically seen what they would view as extremely lengthy delays, right, in the permitting process. And to your point, yes, how incrementally negative that is. We don't really anticipate a huge amount of incremental growth off the back of streamlining permitting. So again, I think I'm always speaking in terms of what investors or what the market is focused on, but I think far less attention probably on streamlining of permitting at the BLM level. Why? Because incrementally, it doesn't really move the needle. So I think that's really our view, and that's actually what we're hearing from the companies directly as well.
And yeah, I would just add on oil and gas, another thing to keep in mind is that this shale boom that has happened, largely the result of fracking and shale basins, has occurred often on state and private lands. So if you look at like North Dakota and Texas, where a lot of this has occurred, there isn't a lot of federal land ownership there over oil and gas. And so it can be sometimes misleading to see that the trends are federal oil and gas production are declining as a percentage of total U.S. oil and gas production. But really, that's because where the shale boom has experienced the most growth is not on federal lands. And so I think too often there can be snap judgment made that because of regulation or these things that slow down the leasing process on federal lands, that's led to a lag in some way in federal leasing. I don't think that's actually the case. Instead, I think it's, again, it's sort of a larger market trend and based on geography and where the shale boom has taken place.
What about the offshore? Should we expect any changes with regard to offshore leases? And just to clarify, all offshore is better, or the resources in the exclusive economic zone are managed by the federal government. And it was just a few days ago, before the inauguration, January 17th, that the outgoing Secretary of Interior approved the next five-year plan, leasing plan, which doesn't contemplate any leases in the Atlantic or the Pacific, only in the areas in the Gulf of Mexico that already have oil and gas activity, and very limited lease sales in Alaska. Would you expect any changes there? And also, again, an expert question for John, what actually can be changed once the plan is in effect, since it just went in effect a few days ago?
I think what they put in was basically more or less just kind of a moratorium, which I think would be, they could more or less reverse that with just signing a piece of paper. But there would still be then the National Environmental Policy Act thing before you actually let any of those leases. That would be a bigger production. Doing the relevant environmental analysis on that. And in addition to that, you have, the kind of different political dynamics since, Pacific drilling so heavily involves California and involves states that don't favor it. And in the Atlantic, like Virginia and North Carolina are the states that I know of that are more likely to favor the local senators. We might encounter some opposition along the way.
Yeah, John, I guess there's another data point or another lens to look through the offshore space as well, and that's just market fundamentals, right? So when crude was at $30, $40, we saw multiple offshore drillers actually file for bankruptcy. The entire space has been pretty distressed, frankly, over the last 12 to 18 months. So we also need to get to a point on the offshore side in conjunction with the policy actually progressing and moving forward, whereby we actually get a reasonable amount of stability in the crude price to allow these offshore drillers to actually become competitive again in the market. And we're getting there, but we're not 100% there yet. So the dynamics, if they move forward in the right direction and the pendulum starts to swing thanks to Trump, then I think we would believe that a lot of the offshore drillers that some of my colleagues cover with me at Evercore would start to come back as well. So fundamentals, I think, drive the debate as well.
One other area to focus on is Alaska, where I think the Obama administration did some leasing in the NPRA, which is the National Petroleum Reserve Alaska, which had not previously had much development. Any development? I'm not sure. At any rate, they've done some leases there, but there was a lot of mitigation required. There was a lot of negotiation with tribes. It was a slower process, a rather considered process. I think that the pressure will be back in Congress to open and lease the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, as well as have greater leasing in the NPRA. And certainly Senator Murkowski and others in the Alaska delegation have always pushed very hard for increased production in Alaska, so that might be an area where, depending on the markets and the attractiveness of producing there, with the recent pullback from the sort of Arctic oil drilling, I don't know that we'll be seeing that, but I think onshore drilling in Alaska may be something that we would be seeing more of.
Yeah, so just picking up on what's been said, so in the last month, I think two interesting things have happened. So Interior released its final plan for offshore drilling for 2017 to 2022, which doesn't include any leasing in the Atlantic and no leasing in the Arctic, just lease sales in the Gulf of Mexico and in the Cook Inlet off the coast of Alaska. And then the second thing is that President Obama issued some withdrawals of areas from offshore leasing indefinitely, using a sort of rarely used provision within the Outer Continental Shelf Lands Act. And you know, both of those things may be looked at closely by the Trump administration. I think there are a number of reasons to think that they won't be completely revisited or redone. So first, on the five-year plan, so this is a lengthy process. It takes a long time to complete these plans, and Interior just finished a finalized plan. There is some precedent for a new administration kind of reopening this five-year planning process, and in fact, the Obama administration did that in 2009 when it kind of reevaluated a draft plan that had been issued under the Bush administration. But I think we're in a different situation here. We have a final plan, and it might be wiser and just, you know, save time to move on to the next plan that would start in 2022 rather than try to reopen this process. And then on the withdrawals, this is sort of a, you know, an interesting area of the law, but what I've seen in terms of legal analysis, it seems that those really do operate one way, and that the president can remove areas from leasing indefinitely, and the next president can't necessarily you know, undo those. So we may that may be one thing that endures from the last administration.
Tom, you mentioned taxes before. I think Trinidad, you mentioned water adjustment tax. Can you help us understand how it would impact energy?
Sure, I can try. I'm not even sure that the Republicans in the House necessarily know how it's going to impact the energy markets just yet, but I'll give it a shot. So essentially, this is a proposal that was in the Ryan tax blueprint to create this deficit neutral tax reform plan. Border adjustment, essentially a tax on imports across multiple sectors, including energy. $1.2 trillion revenue raiser over 10 years. Really, I think from our perspective, there was not a particularly large amount of noise on this, not only in the investor community, but even in policy circles, I think, up until maybe sort of November, December time last year, and this was even before, you know, that Trump actually won the election. Suddenly now this is just ramped up, and I would say it's become the issue du jour that we certainly spend a lot of our time with investors, not only in the energy space, but outside as well. But fundamentally speaking, from an energy perspective, what we're talking about is taxing our imports of crude oil coming into the US. Now, obviously, based on which refiner we're talking about, which particular state we're talking about, which company we're talking about, there are winners and losers across the board. But I think the net negative, if you're really trying to get this done politically, of course, is what happens if we tax imports on crude? Gas prices are going up, right? So in my experience, that's always just been a political non-starter in Washington. If you want to get an energy policy passed or get something across the ground, the barometer, if gas prices are going up, you're going to have a pretty tough fight ahead of you. So I think the way we're looking at this right now in terms of border adjustment is we're very, very much in the beginning of the process. I believe the House Ways and Means Committee are just putting pen to paper right now in terms of actually drafting legislative text. I had a meeting with investors last week with the Ways and Means at the Senate Finance Committee. In terms of timing, they've told us it's going to take them at least 2 to 3 months to actually get a draft that has any substance to it that can actually go to the floor for a vote. Now, the reason I highlight that is that we're reading all these great articles and a lot of analysis from competitors and also people in my firm that claim that they seem to know all the ins and outs of exactly how this thing is going to work. And yet we don't even have legislative text amongst the House Ways and Means Committee in terms of the folks that are actually going to be trying to move this across the floor. So I think amongst the energy investors I speak to on this, fear would be probably a fairly valid word to describe it. You know, this would be a big deal, clearly a hugely incremental negative for the refiners, as I mentioned. Why? Because they're actually importing quite a large amount of heavy crude right into the US. Actually, for E&P, so the exploration and production companies, we actually view it as a net positive for obvious reasons. They're actually not, you know, importing crude, they're exporting, so again, a net positive there. But I would say again, I think we're right at the beginning of the debate on this. There's a long way to go. Those are probably the sort of energy or market takeaways, but I can sort of open it up to the panel if they have views on where this goes from here or any general remarks. Radio silence.
Fire pitch is probably a good opportunity to open it for questions from the audience. Yes, please.
Two words that I haven't heard from the board from the Trump administration is carbon tax or carbon, whatever you want to call it. And the reason I'm asking that, I've read different papers that say that you cannot really have an effective coal policy of any sort until you have a number, and it's almost irrelevant what that number is as long as it's something between 5 and 50%, so that you can do capital planning, because nobody in the coal industry is willing to speculate with this uncertain environment, regulatory environment, $3 billion on a coal plant, which I think we all agree is not going to be a coal plant, but even on modifications of existing plants, or once you retire. So is there any possibility, or have you seen anything in the papers that are being discussed about for not something that's going to happen immediately, but eventually utilizing some kind of a carbon number that will then aid not just for coal, but also for natural gas and greenhouse gas emissions, a lot of other things that will be able to be measured, pluses and minuses, if you have that number, regardless of what the magnitude of that number is.
I can take the first step, because it kind of relates to border adjustment. I know Alex was just talking about it, so I'll pass it over to Alex. But the short answer, in my view, is no. I don't believe the Trump or the fully Republican Congress we have, frankly, has any interest in going down any road vis-a-vis a carbon tax. Now, there has been some pushback on that thesis, actually driven by the Rex Tillerson nomination, given just an issue that Exxon had a few years ago in terms of their disclosure around carbon. I also don't believe that just because of that, Rex Tillerson will be advising Donald Trump that he should also pursue a carbon tax. Now, the one related point to border adjustment that's somewhat interesting is one of the key debates around border adjustment is if you don't get border adjustment, then how do you get that $1.2 trillion in revenue if you want to keep a deficit neutral tax plan? Now, back in November, in the dark cellars of the Senate Finance Committee, when they were under the assumption that Hillary Clinton may well be the President of the United States, they were actually, we've been told, working very, very hard on exactly what you propose, a carbon tax proposal that they could bring forward and use as a very powerful revenue raiser should we go down the road of corporate tax reform. Now, unfortunately, and again, this is based off discussions we had last week, that has been filed in that basement and will unlikely not be removed from there for the foreseeable future. So I think that's our view on where things stand as of now. I don't know if anyone else wants to kind of weigh in on that or not.
Yeah, I mean, it's clear that carbon pricing of some kind, either through a cap or through a tax, is absolutely, the most sensible climate policy, necessary climate policy, et cetera, but I don't think we're expecting any sensible climate policy.
Yeah, I'll just add one thing. I mean, I would agree, though I do also agree with the gentleman who posed the question, that certainly having a carbon tax would be an efficient way to get a greenhouse gas reductions. Where I think there may be room for hope, though, is at the state level. So, Washington State had the ballot measure that would have had a carbon tax in place in the state, and unfortunately it didn't pass. But I think there's going to be a need for states to do more of that. And you know, we're already seeing some leadership and some pronouncements of continued leadership on that.
Well, I hope down about 20 hands up. How about you, sir?
What you have not mentioned are three areas that other countries are doing. Hydro in particular, and micro hydro, thousands of possibilities in terms of water flow, solar, and nuclear.
Any?
I think nuclear almost falls under the same bucket as coal to some extent. A traditional energy source that Republicans are very enthusiastic about in theory, but it actually costs a lot of money to push it forward in practice, probably, given the market economics right now. And I'm not sure that they're going to be spending a lot of money on that.
I would agree. I guess on solar, I'll add wind in there as well. So solar and wind are actually probably more bullish, I think, than a lot of folks necessarily are. The consensus, simplistic sounds pejorative, so consensus view, I think, on Trump vis-a-vis solar and wind is that he, you know, hates any renewable fuel source and will try and just, you know, close down every solar, every wind, whatever's going on. That we disagree with that, I think, for one important point, and that was the extension of the five-year solar ITC and PTC, so the investment tax credit for solar and the production tax credit for wind. Now, those were extended for 5 years at the end of 2015, but the nuance around why we think these are kind of insulated from Trump liability or whatever you want to call it, is that Democrats got that five-year extension vis-a-vis the lift in the ban on crude exports. So when that deal was struck, I think Trump is very much well aware now that if he goes after the five-year ITC, PTC, he may well like...
Can you, since I'm the traffic cop on acronyms, can you explain?
Production tax credit for wind and investment tax credit for solar. So these are the tax credits that industry currently get from the federal government for production of wind and for production of solar energy within the US. If he goes after those tax credits, we just believe that he's just unlikely to do that, just given the risk, the inherent risk that would present to the deal that was structured around the ban on crude exports. So we're actually far, I think, more positive broadly on renewables. Deviating again slightly outside of the question, I don't believe that Scott Pruitt is inherently as negative as a lot of folks believe in terms of running the EPA and killing all renewable energy production in the US. There's a lot of wind in Oklahoma. I think he's aware of that and will not necessarily just turn his back on the entire renewables industry simply because he may well be an oil and gas guy as the governor of Oklahoma. I'm sorry, the attorney general of Oklahoma. So I'll pause there and see.
Let's create more opportunities for questions. There's a hand right there in this direction. Yes.
What are your thoughts on the renewable fuel standards? What do you think is in store for RINs? Is that going to go away under Trump? How is it going to thrive or not?
Is that me again?
Anybody.
I'll make else down. You guys can. Sure. So again, I think there's a split view out there in terms of what we believe that the Pruitt-led EPA or Trump will do around ethanol and the RFS. I think, again, the consensus view is he hates ethanol, he hates renewables, so he will throw out the mandate or draw down the RVO, which is the renewable volume obligation, so the amount of ethanol that should be blended into gasoline at the pump on an annualized basis. Again, we actually disagree with that. It's all about, really, I think, the farm state, politics of ethanol. Iowa was a big win for him. He actually, when he was campaigning in Iowa, stated pretty strong support for the RFS and for ethanol. So our actual firm forecast is that we don't expect the 2017 through 2020 RVOs to be significantly lowered vis-a-vis the mandate. We expect RIN prices to stay healthy from here. They have come off a fair amount over the last few weeks, but that's due to an entirely separate debate, which I'm happy to pick up after this panel, but otherwise we'll end up talking about this for the next hour. So I'll pause there. I don't know if anyone else wants to weigh in on that.
Just to chime in on that one. So In 2014, the House Energy and Commerce Committee undertook an effort to do a reform of the RFS under the Republican leadership there. And you know, the Democrats were perfectly happy to engage in a reform effort. We agreed that there were reforms that were needed. But the Republicans basically could never work it out between their oil guys and their farm state guys as to which way they wanted to go on this. And because it was too controversial within the Republican Party, they never moved forward with it. And I don't see that fundamental tension going away anytime soon. So it's unclear what exactly they would do. They may play with the annual mandates that they put in to make it less, to try and make it less burdensome on the oil industry, but it's basically driven by legislation, by provisions in the Clean Air Act, and it's in law, and in Congress really would need to step in to fix it in a major way.
I have a specific question for Jayni. When you hear Tom's pragmatic view on policies and how much it is influenced by gift backs to certain states, and you are working at the Institute for Policy Integrity, does it make you think that's an oxymoron?
I have no integrity. I work on Wall Street.
We try to bring a certain realism to our work as well, for sure. Though one of the things that I'm thinking about, when it comes to the state-federal interaction is, and actually released renewable energy and solar and wind, is that we're seeing that a lot of even more Republican states that voted Republican in this most recent presidential election are seeing greater renewable energy penetration, especially the solar. And in fact, what's encouraging, I think, is that some traditional, even Tea Party Republicans are seeing the benefits that solar distributed generation brings to their communities. It almost has a little bit of a libertarian bent, produce your own energy. And so I think that there is some room for optimism there. And I certainly hope that states can not only take up some of this mission themselves, but make the case to the next administration that these things are worth protecting, then they're worth investing in.
Time for more questions. Yes, please.
What about the Paris Agreement? What do you think Trump will do with that?
Please.
So publicly, he has not been a big fan of the Paris Agreement. I think we can all agree on that. I think the question will be, do they actually try to formally withdraw from it, which could be difficult and could unnecessarily draw a lot of negative attention to them globally and here at home? Or do they just kind of not come up with a plan to comply with the pledges that the United States has made? Of course, under either scenario, it's a huge missed opportunity and it would be extremely unfortunate. Under the second scenario, though, I think there's less of a public relations problem. The most optimistic scenario would be, of course, they keep the pledge and they work towards it. I'm going to keep saying that's a good idea because it's too early to say right now, and certainly we need people touting that view still.
I guess I'd just add as well that the Paris Agreement is non-binding legally. So if he does choose to walk away, optically, yes, it doesn't look good, but there's no, and John, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's no legal mechanism that forces or holds his hand or ties his hands in terms of compliance, right? It's a non-binding agreement. So it looks very good on paper. It encourages us to achieve all of these lofty goals in terms of emissions abatement, but if you really want to force someone to comply, he can just turn around and walk away freely. I mean, there's nothing legal holding compliant.
And yet again, you bring the pragmatic.
It's a non-binding agreement.
I think that would be a real tragedy if he walks away from Paris. It is a huge accomplishment. And even if it is not enforceable, it is certainly, for anyone who's climate policy for 20 years, it is an amazing accomplishment, and it really has moved the ball forward in a
So I think he could achieve pretty much the same results in terms of if he could, he could simply fail to try and meet our targets, and I would expect that at minimum he would do that, which in itself would be a shame. I think he doesn't have to pull out of it, as Tom mentioned, but in order to simply not do anything on climate. But if he was looking for the big optical, I smashed up the Paris Agreement or pulled you out of the Paris Agreement, that would be something he may look to. I think we really don't know.
I agree.
But let me follow up with a specific question there. So the way the Paris Agreement works is it's voluntary, but each country makes a pledge to reduce carbon emissions by certain targets. And the pledge that the United States made was based on various programs that the administration could initiate because it couldn't expect anything from Congress, like no carbon tax. And a key element of that pledge was the Clean Power Plan. So if the Clean Power Plan now, if its fate is uncertain, you don't need to be that cynical to realize, well, okay, so the United States will stay a party, but it doesn't have a meaningful pledge, and it will not direct its policy towards any particular emission targets. So you didn't withdraw, but it's basically the same, is it not?
I don't think so. I mean, one thing is that we would actually continue to make progress towards that. And maybe we would continue to make progress even if you withdraw us altogether. But because of state actions, such as California and other states, and the shifts in the power sector from coal to natural gas, we are just seeing progress towards it. We wouldn't hit the targets without the Clean Power Plan, certainly. And maybe we probably need to do a bit more than Clean Power Plan to actually get the final ones. But I think the message it sends to the world, and in terms of letting other countries off the hook, the argument we always had against domestic action in Congress was that, well, other countries aren't doing anything, why should we disadvantage America? Well, now everybody's stepped up, we're all in it together, and if we then back down or give up and don't fulfill our commitments, then there's much less incentive and pressure for others to fulfill theirs.
More questions? Yes, sir.
On the transportation system, consumes a lot of fuel. What do you see happening to motor vehicle and truck energy efficiency standards? What role do you see California playing? What do you think EPA will try to do to frustrate those efforts?
Well, so that was interesting. The Obama administration established greenhouse gas standards for motor vehicles through EPA and the Department of Transportation, and they are making a significant impact in terms of oil use, oil demand in the U.S. The EPA had promised to do a midterm review of those standards. They just rather rapidly completed their review and found that they did not need to weaken those standards, instead would maintain them. That's a final action. It's not a regulation. It's unclear whether or how auto companies could challenge that if they want to, but they may well go ahead and try and challenge that. I believe for the Trump administration to weaken the existing standards, they would have to probably go through another rulemaking, most likely, though there may be opportunity if they're sued on those on that review to somehow weaken it there. But as you point out, California, alone of all the states, has its own authority to establish motor vehicle standards, and that has been a huge lever and impetus for federal standards because, understandably, the auto industry doesn't like being subject to trying to build cars to two sets of standards, and there's been a lot of push to align those. So
continue to push those forward, potentially. I don't think we're going to see anything getting stronger in the near term, but I think there's at least a reasonable hope that they won't weaken them. I don't know.
Any other responses to the question?
Yeah, well, I mean, just adding to the uncertainty, I think it's the recent statement that Scott Peruzzi during his confirmation hearing about not necessarily granting a waiver to California for their more stringent vehicle standards, vehicle emission standards. And so, you know, this would be almost unprecedented, I think, or would be unprecedented. I think the Bush administration did this briefly, but then they quickly granted the waiver. That's everything. Okay. So one thing that I noted in this is that, you know, Pruitt kind of has this state's rights perspective, but seemingly only when it suits the fossil fuel industry. It just struck me as a particular example of where you have a state that, you know, legally requests a waiver under the Clean Air Act, wants to do something sort of increasing the stringency of regulation, and yet a potential EPA administrator could say, no, we're not going to allow states to be the laboratory of the experimentation in this field, right? So hopefully EPA continues to allow the waiver and California can continue innovating.
One last question, somewhere from this side, if you're handy.
Yes, sir. So I know that in May 2017, the PJM International Connection will be a big energy auction that happens. Is there like any like color that you would like to provide in terms of, you know, whether market forces will prevail or you know, like policy will take the hold of this process?
Are the same rules applied to you? No acronyms. What is PJM?
Unfortunately, I don't have a
Pennsylvania, Maryland.
We can say that one offline. It's a very long.
I can define PJM. It's the regional transmission organization that serves, what is it, Phyllis? 12 states in the District of Columbia. Yeah. Okay. Originally, it stood for Pennsylvania, Jersey, Maryland, but it expanded beyond those borders. But it's essentially. And I didn't say RTO, it's a regional transmission organization that serves much of the East Coast, but not New York State. New York State has its own.
Okay, so do we have...
I was just going to say, we would probably best take it offline. It's a utility wonk question, but I'm happy to have a majority way, which I'm happy to discuss with you offline.
Okay, well, we have reached the end of our time. Thank you very much for your